I think it was Yogi Berra who said, I'm paraphrasing, that predicting is a risky business, except especially if it's about the future. So to deal both with Armageddon and a prophecy of the return is a difficult and serious subject. And when I started writing my books, which began almost 40 years ago, the first book was titled The 12th Planet, I knew then, almost 40 years ago, that whatever volume, the final one in the series called The Earth Chronicles will be, it will have to deal with the end of days, which is the name given by the Bible, in the Bible, to prophecies of the last days, the end time, and any other way that the term in Hebrew, which is acharit hayamim, is rendered. And I really delayed writing that final book for two reasons. Number one is that I felt I need to do more research, and actually took another 30 years of research to be able to give a plausible answer, one which I believe is the correct answer, but at least it should be sufficiently documented to be plausible. And the other reason is that I don't know if everybody will be happy with the conclusions of that book, The End of Days. Certainly, I think many of those that are dealing, specializing in the subject of what's about to happen, have focused recently on 2012 AD. If I wanted to be nasty, which maybe I should be, is I can tell you right off that the only thing certain about 2012 that there'll be another presidential election then, and that no matter who you vote for this time, you will say, let's get rid of the bum. because otherwise, what is supposed to happen in 2012? It is mostly linked with the so-called Mayan calendar or Mayan prophecies, and I'll talk about it in greater detail as we go along. But as I understand what others are saying, is that it is a time that something, the present, the past, will come to an end, and something will happen. And when you are pressing those others who specialize in 2012, and you ask them what will happen, they say, well, there's a planet. There's a planet that makes some great orbit and periodically comes to our vicinity, and at that time it causes all kinds of havoc. And connection or in response to such kinds of prophecies, my answer is that to remind the audience that the same claims were made in regard, I don't know why, but in regard to 2003, and that that's when the planet, the unknown planet, Planet X, will arrive and do all kinds of unpleasant things to us, or maybe good things. And if you will recall, the same kind of prophecies were connected with the millennium, the year 2000. And one way or another, they are always coming back to Planet X. And if you say, what is Planet X? Well, that is the planet about which this guy Sitchin has been writing. So what is this Planet X, and when really is it supposed to come back to our vicinity, and what is supposed to happen when it does? I started to write about it, as many of you may know, in my first book, The 12th Planet. It took me more than 30 years to research that material for that book. It was published the first time in 1976. The English, not hardcover and softcover, but the paperback edition, which is still selling everywhere, had about 50 printings by now, which is a record for the publishers. And the book has been translated into some 24 languages. And I can share with you a personal irritation, and that is that one recent night I was awakened from a sleep, which is not easy for me lately to fall asleep. And the phone, which is also a fax machine, rang around 12:30 a.m. And when I checked who is trying to reach me at this time, a fax from Hanoi that the publisher in Vietnam wants to translate into Vietnamese, The 12th Planet. And though, you know, it's been translated by now to almost any language you can think of, I was thinking to myself, somebody in Vietnam, in Hanoi, after all that that place means to us, this is really something. Now what I did in The 12th Planet, and maybe that is the reason for its success and for its still being so powerfully around, is that I brought to life a civilization that was hardly known before, and that is the Sumerian civilization. I find it, although now more and more I find in articles, in other books, etc., reference to the Sumerian civilization, to the Sumerians, I find that it's still easier for even those who deal with that, like museums, to say Babylonian. For example, there is now in Europe an exhibit from ancient Mesopotamia, where three museums, the one in London, in Paris, and in Berlin, have combined to put together some of their objects and show them in each one of the three places, and they refer to it as the Babylonian exhibit. So almost 40 years ago, when I or anybody else would say to somebody, well, you know, the Sumerian civilization, you would get some kind of a blank look. You know, the Sumerian, you know, what are you talking about? So I brought to life the Sumerian civilization, which was really a most amazing civilization. It blossomed out in what is now southern Iraq, in that part of the world. This is the ancient Near East. This is the Mediterranean Sea, the Red Sea, Egypt, Assyria, Turkey, which was the Hittites then, etc. So about 6,000 years ago, an incredible civilization appeared there, and all those that deal with it use such words as suddenly, unexpectedly, out of nowhere, because there was no gradual or any kind of precedential civilization that you had this and this and this and this was a higher level, a higher stage. Suddenly, from what we may call primitive, though they were not primitive people, but you know, they were farmers, hunters, etc. But suddenly there appeared cities, high-rise buildings, societal organization, kings, priests, codes of law, literature, art, music, musical instruments, all of that within a very short period appeared about 6,000 years ago. And I sometimes find it necessary to ask people to stop for a minute and think, what is 6,000 years? So we are about 2,000 years removed from the time of Jesus. Now, that time was about 2,000 years removed from the time of Abraham. And then add to that another 2,000 years, and that's where we are talking about, where this great civilization appeared so suddenly. And without devoting the whole evening to that civilization and all the firsts to which we owe a debt, for example, if you look at your watch and you have 60 minutes in an hour, why do you have 60 minutes? Because that's the basic Sumerian mathematical system called sexagesimal base 60. They went from 1 to 60, and then, like we go from 1 to 100 and 101, then we go, they went from 1 to 60 and then 61, so there was base 60. A circle has 360 degrees. Why? Because it is 60 times 6. Indeed, the whole Sumerian mathematical system was based on that. 6 times 10 times 6 times 10, etc. So you had 6 and 60 and 360 and 3,600 and so on and so forth, up to very high numbers in going. Some tablets were found with starting with mathematical tables with 2,196,000 and tables of division from that. So the legacy of Sumer, be it in the first wheel and so on and so forth, is really incredible. So, but I want to mention tonight at least three of their firsts. One is writing. And they developed a writing system called cuneiform, where they describe using a stylus would make wedge-like symbols or indentations in wet clay, which when it dried would become a permanent record. I don't have a sample of a tablet with me, but let's say that this is a clay tablet, and I once held up a copy of my book, not this one, this is a DVD, and I said, which one of the two do you think would last another 1,000 years, the printed book or the clay tablet? And the answer is the clay tablet. So we have writing, which of course meant a language and grammar and literature and epic tales, and lullabies were written down, recipes. For example, in the book, The 12th Planet, I give as an example a recipe for what the French call coq au vin, meaning a chicken cooked in wine. There were proverbs. It's really mind-boggling, but I won't spend the whole evening on that. So writing was one of them. Another thing was pictorial depictions. They took stones, mostly semi-precious stones, and made cylinders about an inch or so, sometimes longer, but basically about an inch, a cylinder of an inch, and would engrave, and nobody has figured out to this day how, in this hard stone, they would make an engraving in reverse, like a negative, which when rolled on wet clay would become a permanent Egypt, a permanent depiction, the way we say print our presses, the rotary presses now, the newspapers. So literally thousands of cylinder seals, and even more so, their imprints have been found, and any museum worth its salt has these cylinder seals or their imprints on display. And those depictions tell us a lot, and I will refer to some of them. And the third thing that I would like to mention and stress this evening was the high-rise buildings. They were the first to use bricks and to build high-rise buildings, like stage pyramids that would rise 100, 120, 160 or more feet high. Some think that these were the towers of Babel, mentioned in the Bible. Actually, it's not so, but every major city, Sumerian city, had a sacred precinct, and the sacred precinct had such a ziggurat, as they were called. And they were used primarily for astronomical observation. And indeed, their knowledge of astronomy, or in the field of astronomy, is one of the most amazing Sumerian legacies. This is, for example, the imprint of a cylinder seal. You can actually see the seal in Jerusalem. There's a museum there called Bible Lens Museum. And this is, if you ask a regular scholar what is it, they'll show it. He'll say this is a beer drinking scene, because the Sumerians were also the first to invent beer. And drinking beer was a social event. You can see people are coming to participate in that. And beer was drunk through a straw. The way I understand in, say, in Latin America or in Argentina, they drink mate tea with a straw. But as many other cylinder seals, they were decorated with celestial symbols. And if you study this one, you find out that it depicts the sun. It depicts the earth and its moon. It depicts what we call the asteroid belt, which is a belt orbiting between Mars and Jupiter, and nobody knows, or nobody, I mean, I say nobody because I do. Others claim they don't know how it came about. It's the remains of some planet that was destroyed, exploded, except that if a planet explodes, the pieces fly in all directions, and in this case, they orbit like a belt between Mars and Jupiter. So you also have Mars and Jupiter, here's Jupiter. You have the asteroid belt, which we have discovered only in modern times. And beyond Jupiter, you have Saturn and its rings, which we did not know about until the invention of the telescope. Now, this cylinder seal is from about 2000 BC, from 4,000 years ago. So this is an example of the amazing Sumerian knowledge in astronomy. But there is even one more amazing cylinder seal, which caused quite an uproar at the museum where it's kept. It's in a museum in Berlin at the time when I came across its existence. It was East Berlin, but they cooperated with me. They sent me a photograph. And if you ask scholars what what is the scene depicted, they say, well, this is the god of agriculture granting the plow, a primitive plow, to mankind. A representative of mankind is introduced by a lesser god to the main god who grants the plow. And just as an aside, I'll say so, you tell those same scholars at the museum or in any of their scientific magazines, say, so there was a god of agriculture, and that's how you look. They say, no, no, that's a mythological scene. That's just mythology. But whatever it is, there is an interesting celestial depiction on this one, and this is what it shows. It shows a star surrounded by planets. Now, this arrow is my addition to enable comparison with our knowledge of the solar system. So we have the sun, not the Earth, we have the sun in the center, surrounded by planets, all the planets we know of in the correct sizes and in the correct order, except that here there's one more planet, right here, between Mars and Jupiter, where the asteroid belt is now. So according to the Sumerians, there was a planet there, probably, or one must conclude, the planet which apparently broke up somehow. Now, if you could get hold of Sumerian guy and said to him, what planet was that and what is the somehow? How did that planet break up? He'll say, well, that's you're asking me something that has been written about in one of our books. It happens to be a clay tablet, not the way we think of books. And that tablet is actually part of seven tablets. And once they were discovered in a library in northern Mesopotamia, in an ancient library in northern Mesopotamia, and the contents of that story on those tablets was deciphered, they have since been referred as the seven tablets of creation, paralleling the biblical tale of the 7 days of creation, 6 days of actual creation, and then 1 day in praise of the Creator. So this is one of the tablets, I think the fourth one out of the seven, known as the Epic of Creation, or sometimes known by its opening lines, which is how the Sumerians used to name their epic tales or their tablets in library catalogs, because they were actually set in libraries, and on each shelf there was a tablet that listed all the texts that are on that particular shelf, like a catalog tablet. So no, it's not sometimes known by its opening words, Enuma, Enuma Elish. Now, what does the Enuma Elish say? The Enuma Elish says, tells the story how the Earth came to be, how our moon came to be,